is coming but is not here yet. Everybody, glad you could come. Our colloquium speaker today is Professor Gregory Gotherin of Eastern Illinois University. He's going to talk about the two-ball billiard dynamical system.
Okay. The aim of my talk is to explain to you how billiards, okay, billiard balls, count number pi, every single digit of number pi. Okay, so I will tell you, this will be the second part of my talk, the longest one. And the first part, because I will tell about pi, I will start with part one, which is just, I will tell you some information about pi, a little, which some of which I just learned recently. Okay, and when I finish the second part, the main part of my dynamical system, I will tell you two big problems posed by Professor Sinai, Yakov Grigorievich Sinai. He's professor of Princeton University and also Moscow, the University of Moscow, and he is the winner of Abel Prize this year, 2014. He got in May 2014 for his beautiful works in dynamical systems. And I will tell you two billiard problems he posed and many years ago, and finally the problem was solved, and part of that work I also made. Okay, so let me call my first part zero. Okay, so it's just because I will tell you maybe some things which are known. So first of all, you know that by Archimedes, is it correct? So this is I?
Yes.
Archimedes, so he found that pi is between, okay, now I want to, so it's not true. I want to either increase one or decrease the other one. So you see, I want to write 1071st, where I have to write it, here or there, just for students. Here or there, 1071st. Okay, some it will be 1/7 and the other is 1071st. Where? On the left?
Right.
On the right? Left? Are you sure? Yes, indeed. If you write 1070s and then you write 1071s, you see that it's greater than that. Because the denominator is bigger. So that's the inequality, and pi is in between these numbers. Now, if you look, if you look at this number, then you will see that this number is equal to the continuous fraction 3 plus 1, 1 over 7 plus 1 over 10. But there is a better approximation given by continuous fractions, and it can be done as follows. So you just write and immediately, I tell you how to memorize that. So you write two ones, then you write two threes, then you write two fives. Okay, then you put here the variant, just, and then you just write the fraction 355 or 113. And that gives the approximation with six digits up to 1,000,000. So that number is 3 plus 1 over 7, and instead of 10 here, it will be 16. And if you calculate, you will get 3, 1, 4, 5, 9, 2, and after that, the next digits are incorrect. So these digits are incorrect. But nevertheless, six digits are correct. So you see, it's a very good approximation by based on continued fractions. So instead of Archimedes should have been smarter than change the 10 for 16, and then he would be good completely. But let me just also tell you a curious equality. Now I just have to write up approximately equal to. Also, you take 92 and change the digits and you get 29. This is not a good approximation, but it's okay. It's symmetric. Okay, I need to say the following. So, but the best one, which I love, okay. The best one which I which I like to use, because it gives much more digits, a little bit more digits than this one, is based on a small Russian poem. And I will, you'll see how fast I will write it down. I don't remember this number, but when I say this poem in my mind, then I just write down, then I will pronounce it. Maybe you will not understand, but it gives the answer. So, phi equals that one. I okay, the poem finished on that phi. That's why. That one. Okay, this one. 5, 3, 7. Okay, so it's pronounced as follows. I will tell you, and you will see that it's indeed fine. A point. So this point, чтобы, so in Russian, pi is called p instead of pi. Okay. Чтобы p запомнить раз, I will tell you in English after the translation. Чтобы p запомнить раз, нужно чаще повторять 3, 14, 15, 9, 26 и 5. Okay. So, to remember this number, you have to repeat as often as you could. 3, 14, 15, 9, 26, and 5. Okay, almost in English, but in Russian just immediately. If you, I've heard this once, only once in my life, and immediately memorized that. And after that, once you have 5, then it will be 3, 5, 8. What is that? It's Fibonacci numbers? No. 2, 3, 5, yes. It's, two, oh, yeah. Yeah, 2, 3, 5, 8, yes. 3, 5, 8. And then after 8 goes 9, then what's left over? 7? Yeah, less than 8. So different digits. Okay. Okay, and do you know, by the way, so I could write also continuous fraction for pi, which is as follows. 3 plus 1 over 7, I start with the same. But actually, this is 16, is actually 15 plus 1. So I just write 15 plus 1. Actually, that one is better. Next one is 292. Yes, but after that, you see it will be 1, then again 1, then again 1, and then again, then 2, and then again 1. Then I will cross it in the end. So then 3, then 1 again, and then 14. And then 1 half, and then again 1, and 1, and I don't know what else. You see, there are pretty many ones, and to find interesting question, how many ones, how many twos are in that continued fraction? I mean, the fraction of what is the fraction of ones, fraction of twos, and so on. It turns out that ergodic theory could be applied here, and the answer could be found out that. Approximately, so then you see the number of ones is pretty big one. I don't remember the answer right now. It's almost the same as if you take, for example, 2 to the power n and write okay, and concentrate on the first digit. Okay, how often the first digit could be 1, how often could it be 2, how often could it be 3, and so on. It turns out that it's based on ergodic theory. You can find, you can predict how many, what is the digit 1 appears much often. Number 2 is much often. So number 1, as I remember, so if this is 1, it will be natural log. Yes, log of 10 ninths. And for 2, if you write 2, it will be log 9 eighths, and so on. And almost the same thing works in here, but this is not the topic of my not the topic of my talk. Do you know, actually I could write some more fractions, but let me stop on that. The only what I can say is the following. It was three, from ancient world up to now, it was three different three different eras. The first era was geometric, which concerns ancient Greeks and that kind of stuff. So they.
Where do you get the continuing fraction? How do you get it?
From the internet. But I know a lot about it. So you see, ergodic theory comes if you just take hyperbola and then you solve the equation x equals fraction part of 1 over x, there is a transformation t which maps x to 1 over x, then fractional part, and so you just take hyperbola, and then you cut into many parts, and then you move this part down, so you have a picture like this one. So like that one, it goes in this way, and then if you take some segment, you take the pre-image in here, and then you find the projections of the segments, and then you calculate the total sum. This would probability that this digit or that digit will be. Okay, I'm not ready to tell you the whole story, but it's a different talk. Okay. Okay, what I need to say that it was three eras, geometric eras based on the inscribing a regular polygon and doubling the number of sides. And for this one, the best result was found in ancient, not ancient Europe. It was found in ancient Japan. So some mathematician, he considered 3072 Gan, and he found the algorithm actually for calculating pi. Pi is approximately this a, 3 of 72, which is equal to, and that formula, let me just write, because it takes only 3 times 2 to the 8 times, and then square root of 2 minus, and then after that you have to write 8 2s. Plus with plus all the time. Okay, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8. And if you calculate that, it gives very, very good approximation if you know how to calculate. It's also a very beautiful formula on that.
How long ago was that?
Huh?
How many years ago was that discovered?
So it's approximately the same. Time is Archimedes unit.
That's
yes, that's good. so beautiful. There are so many formulas. I can simply try, for example, this one. Found in India. 4 over 1 minus 4 over 3 plus 4 over 5. And that one, it was found in India, but it's called Leibniz formula. It's 4 over 7, 4 over 9, minus 4 over 11, plus and so on. So if you divide by 4, you get pi over 4 equals the standard thing, which comes from arctangent of x. And I will use, by the way, in my dynamical system, arctangent x equals x minus x cubed over 3 plus x to the cubed over 5 and minus and so on. And that comes here. Nowadays, it was recently found that the name of the person who found that is Madhava of, and that name is very long, Sengamagrama. And now it's called the formula of Madhava Leibniz. Because before it was called Leibniz, now it's called this way. Okay, let me just write. There is some formula by Vieta, also beautiful one by Welles. Next step was mathematical analysis. Okay, so it was second era. Okay, Leibniz used this one. Euler used some formulas. And for example, there is a beautiful exact formula for pi. Is this one? It's 4 arctangent 1 over 5, 1 fifth minus arctangent of 1 over, what do you think is in here? 7, 11, 12, 239. So this is
true.
Huh? So suppose I give you this, do you know how to prove that? You have to take tangent of both sides. A tangent of pi, by the way, is what's tangent of pi? It doesn't intersect, so you have to divide maybe by 4 first and then tangent pi over 4 and get 1. Okay, and nowadays era is computers. Okay, computers calculate a lot of signs. For example, in 1975, Richard Brent and Eugene Solanin found an algorithm that doubled the number of decimal digits. If you know these decimal digits, one more step and the number of digits doubles. So they found, after 25 iterations, they found 45 million correct decimal digits. After 25, only 25. But in 1997, it was Simon Plouffe found out some very beautiful formula. Now it's called Bailey-Borwein-Plouffe formula, which is expressed in terms of some series. In base 16, it can be that formula allows to find each digit without knowing the previous digits. Just immediately, if you want to find digits on that place, gives the formula. Okay, in 2009, in Japan, in the University of Tsukuba, it was found pi with 2,576,980,377,524 digits. I could write this number. it happened in July. In August, in France, Fabrice Beller found, 2,699,000,000. And then 99999, okay, in the end on the zero. So many decimal digits. But in October 19, 2011, Alexander G. and Sigaru Kondo found 10 trillion digits. So this is indeed a big step in comparing with Archimedes. So, now I have to mention another very important probabilistic approach to that problem. So it's kind of dynamical system, but probabilistic. It's called Buffon's needle method. Maybe you've heard of that, but I just tell you. The thing, so you just on the floor you just draw lines parallel, on the same distance, and then you take a needle whose length is exactly equal to the distance between the lines, L equals D, and then you just drop the needle arbitrarily, just randomly on the on that plane, and then you find the number of intersections. Sometimes it intersects this way. Sometimes, very rarely, this way. So let me just move it. Okay. Sometimes it goes this way, and sometimes like that one, and so on. So you just take n tosses. Okay, you make n tosses, and k intersections, and then it turns out, and then you just tend n to infinity, and also k tends to infinity, and it turns out that the ratio tends to 2 over pi. And so therefore, if you, now computer does that, so if you make it 1 million times, then you find pi equals what? 2n divided by k. So pi is approximately 2n over k. And very, very good approximation. But you see how to toss it randomly. So you have to, so the angle is random, okay, angle theta is random, and also the position is random, so the midpoint, say. So it requires probabilistic methods. Okay, now I go to my system, a dynamical system, and that system much, much simpler than everything I told here, but on the other hand, it's completely deterministic, and also it's so simple that you will see, and it gives all digits, all the digits of number pi immediately. Not immediately, okay, just if you tell me, so find the 1 billion, the digit number 1 billion. So I take two balls, respective balls, collide them, and then count the number pi up to that digit. Okay, so let's start with the second part.
How quick is the convergence in the needle method?
How fast?
Yeah.
Maybe I can't answer right now.
Okay.
So it's
okay.
I have a dumb question. How do you implement that on a computer without knowing pi? How do you pick the uniform random?
No. So if you go to the internet and ask, okay, Buffon's needle method, calculate, it will give you a screen, okay, some screen, and then you push and say, okay, 100 tosses, and then start doing that, and it gives you.
But I guess naively, I'm thinking I pick a random angle between zero and 2 pi, but I need to know pi to start with.
No, okay. So where pi is hidden here? Oh, that's the question. Or
well, no. I'm saying, how would you, if you wanted to use this algorithm to approximate pi, how do you unify?
By hand or by computer?
By computer. How would you pick the random distribution that you're using without knowing pi beforehand?
Pick a random pair of points the right distance apart.
Yeah, okay, so go to the internet and then explain in a couple of sentences that gives you the problem. So you can use your own N, okay, 1,000, and we'll do this in minutes and give you pi with the approximate number of digits. Okay, now let me write the.
Two-ball
Billiard dynamical. Dynamical system count pi. Let me just count all digits of pi. Okay, so I start immediately with the procedure and the theorem. First is zero procedure. Okay, procedure is as follows. I take the line, okay, suppose it's a positive, the positive x-axis, so this is x. Okay, this one is at zero, you have a barrier, a wall, and then I put, two balls at point, some point x, and at some point y, but actually they're point-like balls, okay, so they don't have sizes, but they have masses. This is an ideal experiment. So this is mass M, and this is mass capital M. Okay, in the beginning they're in still position. So I put M equals small m times 100 to the power n. N is the number of digits, you have to find n digits of number pi. And I will tell you how to do that. So you put two balls like that. And then, so in still position, then you put, you just push that ball with some velocity v. That velocity doesn't matter. So if you want to count this pretty fast, then you use big velocity. If you want to live 100 years, then you can do this much slower. And after that, what happens? So this ball collides that ball. Okay, that ball, because it has much smaller masses, it will go very fast to the left, and that ball continues moving to the left with a smaller velocity. Then this ball, like I call it ping pong ball, and that ball is like a cannon ball. Okay. Then ping pong ball hits here, and I count this as a second collision. Okay. I will call hits by hits collision and reflection. So collision, then reflection. In the reflection, the velocity changes its sign and goes down. Then it goes very fast in here, collide that ball, so it takes some energy, takes some momentum from that ball, and also moves to the left again pretty fast. And so that ball moves, and eventually, what will happen? So it could move, you see, like a massive, very massive obstacle, which moves slower and slower, but it could happen that the ping pong ball collides infinitely many times, okay? Just theoretically, it could be infinitely many times, and that ball goes closer and closer and closer. Another possibility, another scenario could be as follows. So it goes this way, and eventually that ping pong ball will push, stop the cannonball, and the cannonball will go to the right eventually, and the number of collisions could be also infinite. And finally, the third scenario could be cannonball will go to infinity eventually, and that ball will not catch it anymore, and the number of collisions will be finite. It turns out that the first scenario cannot happen, the second cannot happen, only the third scenario can happen. The number of collisions in that system is finite. And let's call this number of collisions by pi of n. Okay, so it depends on n, right? So if I put n is 0, then I have equal measures. If I put n equals 1, it will be 100, and so on. Okay, so let me just write, formulate immediately the theorem. Okay, the first part I missed, I will not write it down. I said the number of collisions in this system is finite, and the number of collisions will be equal to 3, 14, 15, 16, 9, 20, 26, 28, a sub n. So many. Not factorial is not factorial. Okay, let me just frame this one so factorial. So it will be exactly so many digits of number pi. That's it. No computer, no anything. Okay. And I know that you don't believe me, but I want to prove that I'm right. That it will be this, that number. Okay, so how to prove this theorem? So this is number one. Okay, number two. From this system, I will go to the so-called configuration system, configuration space of the system. Okay, the configuration space of the system. And let me just... will be enough room for that. Okay, so I consider I introduce the x and y, and you see, instead of considering two balls, I substitute these two balls by one point with coordinates x and y. Mm-hmm. So what do we have? If the balls collide, we have x equals y. So I draw the diagonal x equals y. In here, it will be collisions, right? So if one's configuration point is a point which with coordinates x and y, okay? Now, in the beginning, it was, this is x of 0, x changes in time, and here we have y of 0. So this is the initial point, capital P. Now, but always x less or equal than y, so therefore, I have to consider the point P is located above that line. Also is greater than zero, greater or equal than zero, so therefore it will be on the right side of the y-axis, so therefore configuration space, the region where the configuration point P could be located. That represents our system can be located in here. And now let's look what will happen. Let me just consider a very specific case n. Okay, case n equals 0. In this case, capital N equals small n. How many collisions will be in that case? If the masses are the same, then it will be collision, first collision, then that ball will stop and the other one will go with the same speed. Mm-hmm. Now, first collision. Now, it goes here and reflects from the wall. So the velocity will be moved to the left. Second collision. After that, you just collide that ball, which will be somewhere here in the still position. Collide it, and that ball will go to infinity, and that ball will be in still position. So three. And what is three? The first digit of my number.
Okay, that one's good.
Three. So let's look what will happen in this case. So the ball will go here, and then it will be reflected this way. Okay. So when x equals y. Okay. This one is x equals y. X of zero. Just one second. Yeah. When this ball goes here, x doesn't change and y decreases. Okay, y becomes smaller until it becomes equal to x. So therefore, I have to draw the point P goes along the vertical segment. Then collision happens, and then after that, y doesn't change. So this will be y. And x changes. X becomes smaller and smaller until it comes to zero. Okay. And after that, what will happen? So it start going backwards, and again collides that ball, and this ball will go to infinity. So it will be one, two, and then three collisions. So it's clear. Okay. Number of hits. So number of hits. Equals 3, which is the integer part of pi. Now, I have to consider general case number 3, the mechanics of ideal collisions. Okay, so what I have to write? So first of all, there is the law of momentum and the law of energy. So let me write this one. So that one is capital V, and you have, after the collision, we have the following: mu plus capital MV, small v, let me start this way, equals m times v. And mu squared over 2 plus mv squared over 2 equals capital V squared over 2. Okay, and after that you can, from this system of equations, you can find small u and v. Then after that, when this ball will go to the speed u, and that will go to the speed small v, then u will be changed for negative u. Then write a new system of that equation, calculate second collision, then again, but it's very tedious work and almost impossible. Generally, what happens on this current collision, so intermediate collision? So we just write the same thing: mu1 plus mv1 equals mu2 plus mv2, and let me just multiply by 2 the second equation, get rid of the denominator. So we have mu1 squared plus mv1 squared equals mu2 squared plus mv2 squared. So and then you, if you know v1 and u1, you can find v2 and u2 and v2. So there is some map that moves, that maps u1 v1 to the u2 v2. Now, let me just miss one calculation, number 4, okay, my item 4, I don't want to use some algebra. So, you can do the following. For example, in here, in the beginning, if I multiply by 2, and then multiply by V here, and multiply by V every single term, and then subtract, you'll get zero on the right side. You have the difference in here. And if you calculate, Okay, let me just write. Let me just write the motion. The motion of the configuration point. Okay, how does the point move inside that angle? So when you calculate, you will see that. Let me just draw here. Okay, this is y equals x. X and y. So you'll see this follows. It goes down first, then it goes this way. Okay, then after that, the speed, the velocity changes from u to negative u, and so therefore in this case the angle of reflection phi and psi will be the same, and that is exactly the Billiard law. The Billiard law says that if a point goes to a flat line, then the angle of incidence equals the angle of reflection. If you have non-flat line, so now then you have to draw the tangent line and then calculate, okay, mark the congruent angles. Okay, so in this case you see, if you multiply by v, subtract, make some algebraic transformations, you will see that the motion will be exactly like that. It goes here, there, and there. Now, after that, after the second collision, it will go again, but not parallel, somehow this way, and again it will be Billiard collision. So, Billiard collision happens all the time at the wall, but not Billiard collision. So, let me just write alpha, beta, alpha, alpha is not beta. Okay, much different because the masses are different. You know, I could write it down, but I don't have too much time. And so that behavior of the configuration point is describes the behavior of that system which I told you before. So what could happen? First collision, then reflection. Collision, reflection, and it could happen that this point goes in here will be trapped inside the angle, or another possibility, in which case that ball just, pull the small boy, squeezes, the policeman squeezes. Okay. Another case, it could happen that it will be, some number of collisions, and then it go this way, and eventually like that, but also it could be infinitely many, and the other possibility, finitely this point will go in such a way that this ray and that and the side of the angle will diverge, so no collisions anymore. And it's exactly what I want to prove, that this is the case. Unfortunately, to work with this configuration space is very inappropriate. And so next, what I want to do is just to introduce real billiards. Reduction, let me just write reduction. To a billiard inside an angle, let me write alpha. Okay, so far we have what angle? So that angle is 45 degree angle, pi over 4. let me do the following. From that configuration space, I will make a linear transformation, namely with the following matrix. How call this matrix? Okay, call it T, suppose. I just multiply the x coordinate by square root of the mass of the small m mass. Okay, let me just write square root of m, and the other one is I multiply by square root of capital M. So what will happen? Then I will draw the picture. So I introduce new variables. X equals square root of m times small x, and capital Y equals square root of capital M times Y. So that was the transformation. If I multiply by XY, I'll get this. If I make this transformation, then it will start again exactly perpendicularly, parallel to the Y, to the capital Y X. Now this is capital Y and capital X. Okay, now let's look. So these are the new coordinates of point P. Okay, let's look what will happen in that angle. By the way, so what is what is that angle? Angle equals, if you drop the perpendicular, okay, drop the perpendicular from this point up to here, you'll have square root of m, and this will be square root of capital M. So you have a vector, okay, you have vector n, which is square root of m, square root of capital M. And the angle will be just tangent of the angle equals small square root of small m divided by square root of capital M. So it's, therefore it's arctangent square root of m over capital M. And that number is very small. That number is small because the ratio is too big. It's very big. Okay, so now let's look what will happen. What will happen with the velocity? If I take if I take the derivative with respect to t, so x and y are the functions of t. So if I take the derivative, which I denoted by dot on the top, like Newton did, so this will be square root of m x dot, and so therefore it just okay, let me just try. So it will be square root of m times u. Okay, I prescribed small u to the small particle. And capital Y dot is square root of m times y dot, so it's capital square root of m times v. So therefore, in the configuration space, I have that linear transformation. The same transformation works in the velocity space. Okay. And now consider what happens to the particle. Just erase. Did you remember that one?
Yeah.
Go here. First. Okay. So first of all, if you have the system capital X and capital Y, then after reflection, the particle goes this way and then reflects in that way. As before, the angle of incidence will be equal to the angle of reflection, because nothing changed. I multiplied by square root of m and m, and so velocity changes in the same way. So the angle doesn't change. So therefore, the reflection from the wall will be Billiard as before. But now, the most important thing, what happens, okay, what happens if, okay, so it goes this way, then it goes this, that way, and then reflects. Okay, I claim now that the angle of, that the collision, that the collision of the balls in that new system will also satisfy the Billiard law. So that this, okay, that the angle of reflection equals the angle of incidence. Okay, how come? You know, instead of writing, I rewrite the system of equations. Instead of writing m capital N times V or whatever in the middle, I just write constant number one. And here I write constant number two. And then I go to geometry. Geometry is as follows. I take, introduce vector n, which I used before, the square root of m, square root of m, with these coordinates. And another vector I will call, what do I call it? Okay, w. It's a two-dimensional velocity. And that one is the following. It's square root of m times u capital square root of n times v. Okay, let me introduce. So that vector is constant, that vector changes in time. But now let us look. How can we rewrite these equations? M u plus mv. It is the same if you take this, the dot product. Mm-hmm. Okay, m square root of m square root of m gives me m. Then this gives you capital M, and then you have to add it up, so you have a constant. You can rewrite this as follows. So n dot product with w is constant number one. Now, how to write the second one? square root, if you take that vector and take the square of this, it will be m times u squared plus capital M times v squared, which is exactly the left-hand side of that. This is a constant. So if I take square root of this, a constant actually is square root of double energy, because I multiply by 2, that's why. So it's another constant. You see, so these laws can be written in that simple form. And that one is the crucial moment. The dot product is constant, first, and the length of this vector is constant. But now let's look what is the dot product. It's the length of n times the length of w and times cosine phi. So you have the the equation, what is that? Before it was small x equals y, right? And now you have to write that capital Y equals, capital Y is square root of capital M over small m times capital X. So that this is the equation of in the new system of coordinates. X equals Y. Now, what happens in here? Let me forget about Y to make more room. So it goes that way. So first of all, you have vector n here with coordinates square root of m and square root of capital M. And this one you have vector w, and then after that reflected vector w prime. Now, and let's look. The dot product is this one. It corresponds to the angle phi. Let me just draw it another way. So I just move all the vectors at one point. So I have vector n. Okay, so that one goes along this way. So vector b, w will be here. And after reflection, it will go, so it has some angle. Some angle psi, suppose, and after that it will go this way. Okay, that angle will be phi. Okay, so anyway, look, vector n is constant, the length is constant. The length of this vector is constant, second constant. So, and the product is also constant. So therefore, from here, you'll find that cosine phi is a constant, some third constant. Divide this constant 1 divided by constant 2 and divided by the product of the, just one second. So, yes, it's constant 1 divided by constant 2 and divided by the length of the vector, which is square root of the energy. But anyway, you'll get this result. And so, just looking carefully to the diagram, you will see it follows from here that psi equals phi. And so, therefore, the reflection will be Billiard. Okay, so after that, it will go in such a way that these two angles are the same. Okay, now, the Billiard system is established. Now, after that, the question is, how many... So it goes this way and then reflects here. And how many collisions could happen with a billiard particle with an angle? Okay, let me consider the following case. Suppose you have angle alpha, any angle alpha, and the particle moves in that way. Then it starts reflecting here, but instead of reflecting the particle, I will reflect the trajectory. This is a standard trick in billiard theory. So when it goes this way, then the angle of reflection equals the angle of incidence, and if I reflect that angle alpha, then the reflected ray will be reflected, and it will be a continuation of the initial ray. So it will go that way, you see, in here. And after that it will reflect in here, will be reflected here, okay, and so on. So now I have to reflect one more, and maybe it will be a little bit more. So if I have angle alpha, 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 And so the number of collisions will be the number of point of intersection with this ray and the size of the angle. So how many? Pi divided by alpha. It could happen that exactly pi. So it could happen that this way. Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4. If angle equals pi over 4, then it will be pi divided by pi over 4, which is 4. So, but anyway, I have to take integer part and maybe n plus 1. That is the maximum number equals maximum number of collisions. Maximum possible number of collisions in the angle alpha. Okay, but there is a special case, if pi over alpha is not an integer. If it's not an integer, then you have to find the integer part plus 1. But if it's an integer, then it will be just over pi over alpha, if pi over alpha is an integer. In this case, it will be exactly, you see, you do not need to add one more thing. So when you reflect last time in the irrational non-integer part, then these two lines will be diverge. Okay, so we have this formula. But now, important thing, okay, can I erase that? This one is the key moment of the whole proof. Important thing is when the trajectory goes parallel to one side, of the angle. In this case, the number of reflections will be one less than before. So if pi over alpha is an integer, then the number of reflections in here, okay, so let me just write gamma is parallel to a side. I consider this case. Okay, the number of reflections equals pi over alpha minus 1. But if pi over alpha not in V, then the number of reflections equals integer pi, integer part of pi over alpha without adding this one. Okay, so that one we established pure geometric lemma, and now we go to the final step. So what can I erase? I can erase this one. Okay, now let's look what happens in the configuration space. In the configuration space, in the Billiard configuration space. Okay, so this angle alpha. Okay, that is a calligraphic point P. It starts going this way. Okay, then it reflects by the Billiard law. Then again, and again, again. So therefore, what you have to do? How to find the number of reflections? And you see, if you start to reflect, then next reflection will be just the side parallel to the y-axis. So therefore, we are in that case when the trajectory is parallel to the line. And let me just redraw. Okay. Let me just draw a semicircle and divide into equal parts. Like that, and so the angle is, let me just draw, okay, so the trajectory behaves as follows. We start from point P, and then we have to draw the vertical line up to the all intersection points here. Okay, let's show how many collisions will be in that angle. And the number of those is, so number of collisions equals pi divided by alpha integer part. And actually I could, by the way, I can mark them in in red if it's a collision of the balls, and mark in yellow if it's reflection from the wall. And so every other one is red. So this is that number. And now the final stage, proof of the theorem. I forgot what is the number now. My paper is number 7. Maybe I missed. I didn't try 6 or whatever. Okay, so proof of the theorem. Okay. So number of collisions equals this one. Equals pi divided now what, remember what is alpha? It's arctangent square root of m divided by m. And then you take the integer part. So that number pi of capital N. You see m and m are connected with this formula. Capital M equals this. Now, what is the ratio? M over m. It's 100 to the power negative m. So it's pi over arctangent 10. Okay, when you take square root, okay, 1, 0 will disappear. So you have 10 to the negative n, or 1 over 10 over n. So this is the exact formula. Okay, but now I use the Leibniz and that Indian, very difficult for pronouncing name, for the arctangent x. Arctangent x. Again, x minus x cubed over 3 plus x to the fifth over 5 minus and so on. And then you will see if x tends to 0, then it's approximately equal to x. So we can remove this arctangent, and so we can write this one is approximately equal to pi divided by 1 over 10 to the n, which is integer part. Integer part. So it will be pi times 10 to the n, integer part. And what does it mean? It means 3, 1, 4, 1, 5, a sub n, and the other part is missed. Okay, I need to say the following. So integer part, next what I wanted to tell you, but definitely I don't have time, right?
Yeah,
only one word I will tell. So I need to say the following. So these numbers are very close to each other, and the problem is, what happens with the integer part? Some arithmetic questions arise here, but generally, so we'll have exactly n digits, and that's it. Maybe one word I could say about the following. So I consider the simplest possible dynamical system with two balls. Okay, with one ball it's even simpler, and without balls it's much simpler, but without give you anything. And you see, it's very rich result. I mean, very very rich conclusion we'll get. I need to say that that problem came from the Sinai's two big problems. One problem is the following: what happens if you have on the straight line not two balls but three? If you have three balls, then you can write exactly the exact answer for the number of collisions, which is something like that, integer part pi divided by arc of sine, in this case, square root of reciprocal to f m1 and m3. I don't have time to write it down, but what I want to say, the general problem is this one. So what if you have many of them, then this problem will be reduced to the problem of moving a billiard ball inside the multidimensional polyhedral angle. Okay, so something like that. This one. Okay, something like this. So the particle goes in this way and start reflecting, and you see it's a lot of more freedom. And so eventually, so what happens? Will it be in here? Okay, will it go out? And if how does it depend on the initial position? If you start here or if start far away, and if you go, if the particle goes almost tangentially, what will happen? Sinai proved the theorem. Actually, I proved the theorem about the collisions of Billiard particles. It's a special case of that general result. Sinai proved that the number of collisions is finite, and not only finite, but it doesn't depend on the initial position of the point. It can be estimated from above. And that was a big result, but the general result is this Sinai, let me just write Sinai 1. Actually, if you consider real balls have curvature. And in this case, the collision corresponds to when two balls are here, then you can say that the distance between the centers equals the sum of the radii, right? So therefore, that collision gives you a cylinder in multidimensional space. And you have many multidimensional cylinders, and particle moves outside of this cylinder. So general problem is the following. Almost the same thing, but now, okay, this way. Okay, but now the walls are concave down, so it has, and we go to the so-called Sinai's billiards, a big theory in hyperbolic billiards. And so what happens in this case? Sinai thought that he solves this problem, and up to some moment it was the case, but then it turns out the tangential case could happen, so it goes very close to the tangential case, even exactly tangent. That was some special points. You cannot say so. So it took a lot of years, okay, to finally prove the same result, that the number of collisions does not depend on the initial position, and it was found eventually in Penn State University by three people. One of which is Dima Burago, is a geometer, famous differential geometer, and the other two, now one works in the Wall Street, and the other one I don't know where. So they proved that, finally proved the theorem based on the Burago's idea to cut this, okay, what I said, so, okay, that I reflected the angle, and they, if you, you can reflect this angle also, but very special way, but that one is almost impossible to reflect because the walls are not flat. But nevertheless, it can be cut and then glue again, so you get eventually the so-called Alexandrov space. Okay, and this Alexandrov space, Burago is a big specialist in that, and eventually they found that the number of collisions in balls is less than something 64 n to the power, and again, so approximately. And this to the power, okay, times capital, the largest mass, if you have balls with small mass and big mass, divide by this, and something like that, so to the power n squared. But that is the final estimate, which doesn't depend on the position of the balls. The number of collisions cannot exceed that big number.
I'm afraid we really must cut it off. I know some of the students have to be other places now.